Okay, in this video, I'm going to show you how to deal with repeated measures experiments where you have participants that do a kind of before and after procedure. Okay, so first let's look at an example that's not that way. Okay, so here we have 24 subjects and we have two groups, 12 of them in this group and 12 in this group. And what we did is we're testing the effect of coffee on typing speed on the computer. So here we measure their typing speed in words per minute. And over here we have the no coffee group, and then we have the after drinking coffee group. So let's go ahead and get the data we need for this. Okay, so we'll call this group, we got no coffee here, and we have after coffee here. Okay, so now I got my data. Mean, standard deviation, n for the two groups, 12 each, and then this is the confidence interval. So now let's insert a chart. Let's select our data here. Could probably just do these. So you can see that we have here's our two means and here's our errors, and oh, there's a lot of overlap. So by doing this study where we have two different groups, one without coffee and one with coffee, and 12 people each, I'm showing no difference between these between these groups. Okay? Now, on the other hand, you probably realize that if we had the same people do it before and after, then we could better compare this because, everyone's got different typing speeds. So if we use separate groups, it's harder to account for individual variation. So it's better to have the same people do it without coffee and then with coffee, and then we can see what the difference is. So how do we do that? Well, over here, I have the data put that way. So now I have 12 subjects, and here's before coffee, and over here is after drinking coffee. So now you can see that these are the changes between the participants. So how do we deal with this data? Okay, well, the first thing we're going to calculate is a mean for each participant. Okay, we're going to find the average of each person here. So let's go up here. Let's put our average function here. And we're going to do the average of these two. Okay, there you go. And we're going to do the same for all of these. There, so now I have each person's average. And then down here, I'm going to calculate what we call a grand mean. Grand mean is going to be the average of all these means. So let's do again average, and this time we're going to take the average of all of these. Okay, next, we want to calculate an adjustment factor for each participant to adjust their score based on this grand mean. The way we do that is a formula like this. Notice I used the sum, and D17 is here, it's the grand mean. Okay, and I put these dollar signs so that I'm saying I always want to use this number, and then D4 means this. If I use these dollar signs like that, then I can just drag this down. It'll change the D4 to, D6, D7, but it will keep this number the same for all of them. So then I have my adjustment factor, okay, and now I'm going to calculate an adjusted before and after score, okay, like this. This plus the adjustment equals this. Okay? And I can drag that down for everyone else. Okay? And then in this one, I used the after number and the adjustment to get this. Okay? Okay, now you can see these are my no coffee scores, and these are my after coffee scores, and they've been adjusted now based on this grand mean. All the participant scores have been modified based on this grand mean. Okay, and then we want to calculate our mean standard deviation number of participants and confidence intervals for each of the two cases, but this time we're going to use this data. Okay, so I calculated the means using these ones here and over here using these ones. Now you notice the numbers 40, 47. If I go back to the between groups one, the means are the same, and they should be, okay, because the groups We still have the same averages before and after. But what's going to change is our standard deviation. Okay, so you see our standard deviation is much smaller, and in fact it's the same because we've adjusted these scores. Okay, so now you see I got the new confidence intervals. So let's make a graph based on this. As before, we're going to plot this. Okay, and I added my error bars showing the 95% confidence interval, and now you can see they're a lot smaller. So basically, if I'm repeating measures with same participants, these error bars should be smaller to reflect the fact that the participants are the same and they have individual differences. If you compare, here was the graph before, and then here's the graph now. Now, one last thing I want to show is a common mistake that students make, and that is using ratios to calculate between measure studies. Okay, the ratio method is basically to do this. They take the after value divided by the first value, which gives you a ratio change. Let me calculate that for all of these. Okay, and then let me calculate the mean standard deviation and so on. Okay, so I'm using the average of these ratio numbers here and the standard deviation of the ratio numbers. And let's make a chart of this. Okay, basically, I get this. Okay, now I got an error bar. I'm going to adjust my y-axis, something like this. This is the kind of graph I'm talking about. So now you can see we have zero in the middle, so we know that coffee made it increase. But the problem with this graph is that we can't really see the data anymore. All we see is the change in the data. And readers need to be able to evaluate your conclusions, so you shouldn't hide your data like this. And then one more problem with this is if we actually calculate the mean of each group, okay, like we did before, so you remember that group was 40. Okay, and this group was 47. Okay, and then here we calculated the ratio again. You see that the actual before and after averages, the ratio between these is not the same as the ratio we calculated when we calculated each ratio. So that's another problem with using this ratio method and why you shouldn't do this.